Hi, everyone in the room, and also our viewers online. Welcome to CodamX. So CodamX is a series of weekly talks where we invite industry experts to talk about everything that is tech related. So my name is Qing. I'm your host today, together with Dave. If you have any questions, please write them down and leave them till the end. We'll have the Q&A question. And for our viewers online, please leave your questions on the chat box and we'll get back to you. So now, Dave is gonna do the introduction to our speakers today.
Thank you. So today we have Accenture as our, and we have two speakers. We have Lisa Hartgring and Andreas Garoufas. They will talk about AI in the cloud. How is AI combined with the cloud? How is that going to help businesses? So please all give a round of applause to Lisa and Andreas.
First of all, thanks a lot for the invitation and the introduction. As you saw, my name is Andreas. Originally, I'm coming from Greece, and I live here the last 8-9 years. Also, I have studied also in the Netherlands, more specifically also in Amsterdam. And just to start the discussion, we have prepared together with Lisa just to talk a little bit about IT, about more specifically about cloud technologies, and how we can combine it with artificial intelligence. Here, just a few things regarding myself. Okay, the age, not necessary to, I guess most of you are much younger than me. I live also in The Hague. I was born in Greece, more specifically on a Greek island where also we have windmills, so it's not only in the Netherlands. Just a few things that I like myself, traveling, cooking. Also, I would characterize myself as a foodie. I like also trying new stuff from time to time. And also, something that might be also a little bit interesting for you, what I did also before I joined Accenture, because for Accenture I worked the last 7 years. As you can see, I have 2 masters, and also before joining Accenture and working in a consulting company, I have worked also as a software developer. And more specifically, because both or most of you have already a background and you are familiar with that, I was focusing mainly on databases and actually front-end development. So I was busy with HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and on the back end a little bit with C#. And since I joined Accenture, I focus and I work mainly on the cloud technologies. So mainly working with the key biggest cloud providers, GCP. Actually, this is a cloud platform of Google. Azure, this is a cloud platform of Microsoft. And AWS, which is just the cloud platform provided by Amazon. And also explain a little bit, also you see my title right there, my professional title, Intelligent Cloud and Infrastructure, Associate Manager level. So also this presentation is not only interesting about the content of itself, but it's also, we are also here just to give you an introduction and a little bit of understanding of what a consultant is doing and what a consulting company is doing. It's not specifically about Accenture. It is just in general for all of the consulting companies, because some of you, you might be interested to work in this industry. So as consultants, what we're doing is more or less we're solving problems. So the idea of consulting is based on the fact that the companies, they have to solve some problems. In most of the cases, they do not have the resources. They do not have the people to work on the solution of the problem, or they do not have the expertise to solve a problem. Like for instance, there is one company that says, tomorrow I would like to build a new application, and this application I would like to be hosted in a cloud environment, but I do not have a cloud engineer in my company, or I don't know how to do that. So in order to find the solution, they just hire a consulting company, some external people who are coming to your company, to your office, actually will work on the location of the client. And then we try to understand what is the problem and how we can help them. Especially for Accenture, is actually a relatively big company. We have 3,000 people only in the Netherlands and 500,000 people all over the world. So it is, let's say, from the consulting companies in terms of size, is one of the biggest ones. And we are working mainly with all the different types of technologies. So you cannot find a consultant who knows everything. But within the company, we have different groups. We have people who are specializing on the application development. We have people who are specializing on cloud technologies. People like Lisa who are working with artificial intelligence and machine learning, networking, and many other things, including also some business-related topics. So this is a little bit introduction about, let's say, consulting. What is a consulting company and what we're doing as consultants? And also in the question sections, feel free also to ask a few more things regarding what we're doing on the daily life, or also to give you some examples from projects we're working on, also to get more familiar about our context. Okay? I think also, Lisa, now you can give a short introduction.
Hi, okay. My name is Lisa Hartgring. I am originally from physics background. I studied way longer than is actually useful, so all the way into a PhD. I started out, so especially in physics, and if you stay in academics, you're going to run into like a bunch of super ancient languages, because if somebody debugged it once, you know, it's very uninteresting to rewrite it in a new language, and we just write wrappers and keep using kind of like the old implementations, so that's why you even see Fortran there. And I was like super happy that in my current job I get to use Python, which is finally like some kind of a modern language. I'm super old also, as you can see. I like running, and that's one of my impressive yoga poses, and I work so much that my kid spends time like impersonating what she sees mommy do all day long. And I love reading fantasy, and one of my hobbies is kind of like taking an effort on the internet to kind of combat all the nonsense that people are proclaiming as truth, but in a very respectful, non-polarizing way. So I made like a screenshot there of me trying to convert people. I've been working at Accenture since 2016, so it's been almost 4 years now. It's my first job in like a commercial company, so it's been an interesting change. Yeah, cool. I'll talk about the second part of the presentation where we dive into kind of AI into the cloud.
Yeah. I will switch. Are you familiar with concept of cloud computing, or is it also something that you are using it in your studies? Anyone? Not at the moment. So we'll specifically focus only on the more or less on the software development. Okay. But at least anyone in the room, I guess most of you, but somebody can try also to explain a little bit better what is this term. I mean, what is cloud computing? Somebody would like to give a try to explain to the others what is cloud computing, and then also I can say my part, but let's try to make it a little bit interactive. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Any other example? Maybe if you cannot give a definition, maybe can you give an example of cloud computing? Anyone, for instance, a Gmail, or let's say you have Outlook.
On the cloud.
Yeah. Exactly. More or less the idea and the concept of cloud is based on the fact that I can use IT resources, like for instance storage, or I can use also, let's say, process power. And how do I access it? I cannot access it physically. I do not have, for instance, a hard disk in the other room or a server, but I can access it via internet. And this is also something that also what, if you remember also the first picture we put, it was that at the end of the day, there is no cloud on itself, even though it sounds quite abstract as a terminology. But on the other hand, what I'm doing is I'm just using the infrastructure but that is being provided by somebody else. So at this moment, let's say we have some, let's say vendors, some companies like Amazon, like Microsoft, or like Google, they have very big data centers, and not only one. Actually, their data centers are scattered all over the world. And what we are doing is actually we pay some money to them in order to use some of the resources which are available on their site. It's like, for instance, like the Gmail, or like, for instance, when I put my photos on the OneDrive, or when I have, let's say, my data on Outlook or on the Dropbox.
What am I doing? I pay maybe $1 or $2 per year or per month, and I have the opportunity to put my photos over there. When we're talking about, let's say, the business context, where I have very big clients and clients which have a lot of servers and they have also a lot of data, then the scale is massive. Then we are not talking about a few gigabytes of data, but we are talking about terabytes of data. And I'm not talking about one server, but we are talking about thousands of servers. So this is a little bit the idea of cloud computing. And also about the cloud computing, because it's also quite generic terminology. Under the cloud computing also, they have different models. And maybe some of you have seen at least some of these terms. The most basic and the most traditional one is on-premises. Actually, in the past, but still there are a lot of companies, for many, many reasons, they said, okay, I would like to have the responsibility about my own resources, about my own infrastructure. So what they did, they were building their own data centers. For instance, a company like ING or like KPN, they do not have even one data center in the Netherlands, they have multiple of them. Has anyone seen, or maybe do you know what is a data center? Anyone, data center? So it's just a building maybe like this, it's not something special, but let's say this is a place where I can just put a lot of servers. So instead of having them here and there or between the offices, I just, let's say I have a specific place. In this place, there are some regulations and specifications regarding the ventilation system or the security or whatever. And it's just a place where we can just host a lot of servers. So in the past, what the companies were doing, because they didn't trust anyone else, and also the technology was not mature enough, every company, they were just managing their own data centers. And maybe what is important for you, you can see, let's say, that on the bottom part, we have more or less what is related to the infrastructure, like, for instance, the operating system, the servers, the storage. But maybe what is also more important for you is also that here on the top, we have also the applications and the data. So you as developer, for instance, if you go to work for a company like this, that they have their on-premises infrastructure, if tomorrow you want to say, okay, I want to work as an application developer, and I want to develop an application which supports this functionality, you will have to request from this company to deploy one server for you. You have to get access to you and you can start coding. This is how it was done in the past. Even at this moment, there are companies which are using this model, but let's say now we are changing. Now we have, let's say, two models which has been introduced quite recently. I mean, maybe the last 5 years are quite popular. I have the infrastructure as a code and the platform as a code. The infrastructure as a code, what does it mean? That this bottom part, which is related to the infrastructure, like for instance, the networking, the storage, the servers, I am moving into the cloud. And instead of having a server on my data center, I have a server that I just, a virtual machine actually, that is running on the data center of another company, as we said, like Google, like Microsoft, or like Amazon. So this means that I do not have to worry at all about, let's say, where this server is running, or how is it running, or whatever. The only thing that I have to work and I have to worry is how to manage the applications, the data, and the operating system. Simple as that. And maybe you can start wondering why is this so important, or what is the change, or what is the benefit out of that. For instance, if let's say you have to manage everything yourself, if you have to manage everything yourself, and tomorrow, for instance, I have the need to order a new server, I have to call my vendor, I have to tell him, okay, I need a new server for this and this purpose, I need also these specifications, so this will take some time. But when I have and I'm using clouds and this specific model, I just go into a web interface. We can show it also later on how it looks like. Very, very quickly, like Hausberzocht, I want one server with these specifications and it is ready in a couple of minutes. Simple as that. And in 10 minutes from now, I have a server where I can start developing my applications. Is it clear the difference between the on-premises and the infrastructure as a service? Platform as a service, it might be even more interesting for you. Companies and cloud providers came up with the idea, why should somebody also care about the operating system? Like, for instance, I get a server, and on the top of that, I have to install the operating system, Windows or Linux, and maybe also I have to deploy one specific application. If I'm doing data analytics or artificial intelligence, I have to install Hadoop or Spark. And then the company said, okay, maybe we can create a model where the developers, they do not care about at all about the infrastructure. The only thing that they are doing is they are just focusing on developing an application. So in this model, I have the option to open a web interface, just one portal. I can type my, my code. I don't care where it is running. This is responsibility of the company that is providing this managed service, is called. And then I can start just deploying, doing the compiling, and see the results and continue with my development. So I do not care at all about who is managing all this stuff. I do not have any responsibility. This is the responsibility of Google, Microsoft, or Amazon to provide me this, a kind of a box, of a development box. And then the only thing that I have to do is just to focus on my applications and data. This is a very good concept for a lot of startup companies, that they do not have the resources or they do not have the capacity to start working on these kind of things, and the only thing they want to do is just to focus on the application development. And also here we have the software as a service. Facebook is a software as a service. SAP is a software as a service. Gmail also is a kind of a software as a service. I do not care about anything. The only thing that I am doing is I open my browser, I type one specific URL, I access my application, I work on the application, somebody else is managing the infrastructure, somebody else has developed the application, and the only thing that I am doing is I'm just using the application and I'm doing my work. Clear? Any question? Okay, good. So here you can see actually this list also is getting longer and longer, but let's focus on the first three ones. This is also something that we have discussed already. These are the different cloud providers. Actually, you can see most of the companies, you can actually recognize them. I guess the first three, we know them. Oracle, I think even they have a building somewhere nearby. Huawei, etc. But let's say the most important is just to focus and understand a little bit what kind of services are being available on these platforms. And let's say so far what we have talked is a little bit the compute services. These are more or less the servers and what we discussed before. It's also, let's say, databases, storage, things related to security, application development for service, application services, big data, and also artificial intelligence that we are going to talk later. So this means actually for all these concepts, for all these services, I have the option to use different tools in the cloud environment in order to make my application or my infrastructure a little bit easier or more cost efficient or safer or more reliable, etc. So for these services are being developed by the cloud providers. Actually, the companies which are on the left side are responsible to divide these services. And we, as developers or as engineers, are responsible to use them, and in a smart way, as always, just to support better our company or to develop in a better way our application. And also you can see that, let's say, the variety of the services is something that, let's say, is getting bigger and bigger all the time. Also here, just to understand, let's say, is also quite competitive market, because now there are a lot of companies which want to get in this industry and try to attract as many clients as possible. So just to know how it looks right now, you can see that the three biggest players is Amazon, Microsoft, and Google. Amazon, I guess all of us, we have seen it so far also with Amazon on itself, the products, I mean, it's getting higher and higher in the market. Microsoft also started other ones, now they are dropping. Also Microsoft is going a little bit higher. Also, let's say Oracle and Alibaba and Google also are trying to get an important piece in the market. And now the key question is, why do I think that, let's say, the cloud is also something important? And why do I think that, let's say, I have to use it? More or less, actually, with the cloud, I have a lot of flexibility. What does it mean, flexibility? As we said, I can order and get a server within a couple of minutes. If I do not need a server, I can delete it immediately. So this also has a positive impact on my costs because I pay only for the things that I'm really using and only for the time period that I'm using them. In the past, for instance, I could have a server on my server room that is running there, I don't know for how long, and I do not use it. But in the cloud environment, if something I do not use it, I can switch it off very, very easily. Also, the flexibility includes also the meaning of scale up and scale down. Like, for instance, bold.com on the Black Friday, they know that they will have a lot of customers who are going to visit their portal to purchase some gifts or whatever. So for this specific day, or for the day 2-3 days before the Black Friday and 2-3 days after the Black Friday, where I know that the number of the clients will be increased, what I can do, I can just say, instead of having one web server, I want to automatically scale up to 10 servers. And the week after the Black Friday, I want to go back to the one web server. Again, also, this is related to the cost. And also, this is also related to automation, because the scale up and the scale down is not being done manually, but it can be done automatically. I can just say a very simple rule that on this specific day, I want to have 10 servers. When I was, I mean, in the past, I had to do this manually, and it was also very time consuming. Also, this means that ease of use actually is quite easy to manage and use this environment. And also, most of the companies, what they have noticed, and that's why they are trying to move to this model, is that at the end of the day, when I have less headache and I have to spend less effort and energy on managing my environment, then at the end of the day, I have more time to focus on the important things. And one of the most important things for the companies is just to innovate, support better their clients, bring into the market new technologies or new products, etc. I think that was my part. Also, let's discuss about it at the end. I want just to give the floor to Lisa.
Okay. So then we move into AI, right? So artificial intelligence. So what we're going to be creating is essentially intelligent algorithms. So let's maybe start first with a definition that I attempted to give here. What is AI? So the science of training systems to emulate human tasks through learning and automation. So I think originally when I thought about AI, you know, I kind of like felt algorithms should display some kind of like more intelligent behavior, but actually it really depends on the task that you're trying to automate in a way, if you actually need an intelligent algorithm to get there. So let's explain that with a practical example a bit later. But when we're trying to build like or automate tasks or create algorithms that are able to solve kind of like more complex tasks, essentially I would say there's like two different approaches, right? So there's first the rule-based approach. It's probably like lesson one, day one when you start in this college, right? And if then. So everybody should be familiar with that. A rule engine, so it's great, right? You know completely what's going on. It's deterministic. You have full control. You don't need any historical data in order to build it, right? You can just use human logic and reasoning. It gets kind of complex though when the rule system gets like really large. So imagine if you get like 20 consecutive rules or like, you know, 90 different parameter values and stuff, and then, you know, maintaining that, you know, that's not like, you wouldn't want to have that job when you graduate here, I imagine. So the alternative is, okay, and especially when we don't manage to capture it in rules, there's a statistical approach, right? So if we're not necessarily able to grasp the rules of a system, can we like, you know, get an algorithm to look at a data set and kind of like infer the rules from there? And that's the statistical approach, so that's great, right? Because, you know, algorithms do a great job thinking in many different dimensions, like they really overtake humans when it comes to kind of like inferring in multidimensional space. And the disadvantage is now you're gonna need like a fairly big set of historical data in order to kind of train algorithms on. And also it's a bit of a black box. You know, you kind of gave away this understanding of how the decision is being made to a large extent. Okay, so just bear with me here. So we're going down the path of these statistical algorithms, and essentially what are these algorithms gonna do for us? They're gonna do some kind of prediction for us. And we're gonna train them on large data sets. So that's a requirement here. And we get two different situations. We either get data sets beforehand that we can like understand and we know what's in there, so-called labeled data set, right? So if we have pictures of cats labeled as cats, that's a good example. Then we can do, when we do prediction, we can either predict like discrete variables or continuous variables, right? So that's the difference between classification and regression, essentially. Examples of classification problems in business are, for instance, if you're trying to predict the category of an incoming email, but also, for instance, if you're trying to predict if a certain person is more likely to commit fraud. So it's like you're trying to predict this label for an individual. I think regression is something most people are used to or familiar with from high school, right? So if you're doing any kind of like fits from a function to a bunch of parameters, for instance, if you're trying to predict house prices. Then we have the other situation, because you have a whole lot of data, but you have no idea what's in there. So we call that a so-called unlabeled data set. So if you're gonna try to make any kind of predictions from there, what you usually do is you start with clustering. So you try to understand within your data set, you know, which points are similar or look like they belong together. And then lastly, there's the field of deep learning. And this is a bit of a specific example, because all these earlier algorithms, they still require a whole lot of like manual label before you can like feed it into the algorithm. But in the deep learning case, actually, part of that is being done in the neural net. So I'm not gonna go too deep into it, but I just wanted to like start with the basics behind the algorithm that we're building. So what you need to really take away is all these algorithms are just gonna allow you to make some kind of prediction for a future variable based on a historical data set. Now, this is a demo in the background, because one of the things you also need to realize when you build these algorithms that make predictions, it's very much like a back-end thing, right? But what we've seen in business is that, you know, it doesn't feel very tangible for people. You know, I can wave all my diplomas and say, oh, I'm a really clever person and this is what you need to do. But in practice, we see that that doesn't really kind of like come across when we speak with clients. So we actually spend a large amount of our jobs creating like visualizations of these very much kind of like back-end algorithms. So this is one. It doesn't really demonstrate that much yet in this demo what's going on in the background, but it does illustrate for people what's going on. So this is one specifically about email classification. And we built a demo where people could just like send emails on the fly, and then they could see it getting classified in real time, essentially, which is, I think, a very interesting thing to think about, that that's also going to be part of your job where you're going to be creating these algorithms. You need to kind of convince people what they do and how they're useful. So there's this visualization aspect that you need to take into consideration. Now, what I really like to use also is there's this one aspect of you guys, super clever, right, spending multiple years here understanding how to build algorithms, but when you're going to go into your job afterwards, you're going to get in this situation where business people, you know, and they can go like wild with creativity, and you need to like bridge that gap to these people's ideas and then explaining them what is like super feasible and what is very difficult. And this is a really good comic from XKCD where they're asking for like a geographical label, and it's like, yeah, sure, fine, GIS lookup, and then it's like, okay, you tag the type of bird, and then it's like, no, I need a research team, this is a very hard problem. And this is also gonna be a very interesting aspect when you work with more kind of like complex algorithms, that you need to like bridge the gap to people to explain what is easy and what is like super difficult. I always say, I can solve any problem if you have an infinite research budget, but generally that's not really the case in real life. So, okay, so this is the little intermezzo on AI algorithms and what's behind them. What happens when we bring those kind of like complex algorithms into the cloud? So what we were trying to do is we were trying to predict, and we had all these different statistical approaches or even a rule-based one. Okay, so now we want to build these algorithms into the cloud. So what happens is in the cloud, we have three different approaches, kind of roughly. So we have the approaches aligning to different levels of AI proficiency. So first we have services, right? So that means that the cloud has built kind of like services for us that we can just use off the shelf that fill some kind of like intelligent purpose. We have assistive modeling. This means that they call this auto ML, so you don't need to do a lot in terms of kind of like configuring or training the algorithm. It's more about giving the cloud a data set, and then it kind of like automatically trains an algorithm for you. And the last one is essentially when you build out the algorithm completely yourself. So it's very much similar to what Andreas was saying in a way earlier about the SaaS, PaaS, and YaaS, right? So it has kind of like these different levels where you can step in to kind of like build any kind of AI-fueled applications. So let's start in the way learning usually starts. Let's start with the easiest one, with the services. Okay, this is an overview slide. So consultants really love making slides, not as much as they used to, but still like fairly like it. And this gives you an overview of, I would say, you know, everybody's in the cloud because this is the way technology services are making money these days, right? So everybody's trying to jump on that train, and I highlighted here the specific different functionalities that you have on the area of artificial intelligence. So it ranges from more language services, you know, it's about translation or speech recognition or translation to machine learning algorithms like I briefly explained earlier. So let's take a specific one. The vision API, so one of the things it can do is it can recognize objects on a picture or extract text. And maybe it's nice if we pull out an example here. So, a very appropriate picture here of Amsterdam. Oh, that's not good. It's the demo gods are not. Let's try a different one. No.
Oh, yeah,
let me try.
But still, the full idea is that also you as developers, you can use this API in order to build an application. Let's say, for instance, if you would like to make an application that can recognize the bicycles in a photo. So what you are doing is not necessary to make your application smart to understand where a bicycle is in the photo, but what you are doing is maybe you make a portal where the user uploads the photo, like Elisa what is doing, and then automatically somebody else, like another company like Google, they can already analyze what is in the photo.
Yeah, so for this, these companies, this is a great way for them to make money, right? So they're trying to make it a commodity in the sense that, you know, you don't need AI engineers to use these functionalities or to build out apps that needs these functionalities. You can just go to the cloud and pull out some kind of service that does this. So as you can see, it's recognizing the text really well. We can argue that it's not displaying the bounding boxes very well, so there's some updates to be made on the service. And you might think, oh, this is great, right? Like, maybe you're not really going to be software engineers, but you're going to be software integrators, where other people kind of like build all the functional parts and you just need to tie it together. But you always need to watch out if this actually works for your use case, right? So I think what you need to do as a programmer is think about, okay, how could this potentially break my application if I start using this? So one of the questions I was asking myself is like, okay, well, how does this work, for instance, you know, if this image is upside down? So let me reset it. How does that work? And as you can see, it's automatically correcting from that, right? So it flipped the image, it recognized that it was upside down, and it's still doing a really good job. And then you're thinking, okay, great, right? It handles more advanced cases. But then I was like, okay, let's do a trickier one. Let's rotate it like slightly. Let's see how it does then. And actually, you notice here, so I'm gonna scroll a bit down. So here you see it loses the, it does no call. So here you already see that it starts, you know, system failure. So if the text isn't like outlined perfectly for you, then, you know, this is gonna have limited accuracy. And this is really, as a developer, when you use surfaces, you know, this is where you're still gonna have to think about, is this gonna be fit for my purpose? Which is like all the different variations you can get, and is it gonna break your system? I also wanted to pull out the one with natural language. So I pulled something off the website about Codam. And I think language is a really nice one to also think about. You know, do I need really complicated kind of like probabilistic algorithms, or is a rule-based approach better? So for instance, if you think about Netherlands, like, you know, for instance, all the locations in the Netherlands, you can essentially just create a database, right, containing all of those, and then you can just do a match. You don't necessarily need a very complicated system if you want to recognize locations in a text in Holland in order to do that. But when it comes to like recognizing a person's name in the text, there's an infinite amount of variations, and it's so dynamic that that's a more intelligent algorithm behind that. And that's maybe also a nice explanation about, you know, when we discuss intelligent algorithms, how much intelligence is actually behind the algorithm that's being used there. Okay, so back to the presentation. Okay, so another thing I want to mention is like, okay, a translation API. So people must be using Google Translate, I assume, right? At least I was speaking to a French person recently, and or my French colleagues, and I need it. I think one of the things that's also really interesting is if you think about booking.com, one of the way their customer service centers work is also that they first translate all their messages into a specific language, and then they just have people, you know, who comprehend that specific language answer to the actual customers. Their words are so domain specific to the traveling domain that Google does not give these guys a well enough result. So Booking actually has their own machine learning dedicated group who is building out like algorithms to just translate into, I think, English, specifically for the domain of travel. So you also have to figure out when you use these services, you know, if you're working in a super specific, like a medical domain has a lot of like super highly technical medical related namings, that these algorithms, if they're not trained on that type of historical data, won't perform that well. Okay. you went through all the hurdles, you decided, no, I'm good, I'm gonna use this service, it's the right approach to my problem. What do you still need to be careful about? So one of the things I was really amazed about is once we integrated this into a system, and you think, right, you think that when these guys update, that they would make sure that their JSON responsibility for their API service is backwards compatible. No. So it just like broke our unit test, which I was like absolutely amazed, like, how can you change? But yeah, so that happens, right? So imagine if your app is kind of like live and these guys change their responsibility overnight and the system goes down, so that kind of sucked. Also, you need to budget for unit testing, right? So you're paying per query of the API. It goes like in big batches, but yeah, you need to figure out how much unit tests you're running and how much you need to budget for that. And then this was a really rough one, right? So we at Accenture, we're trying to build platforms. And when we do this, we need to make sure that when we use libraries, that the licensing allows us to kind of build on top of these libraries. It's what you call like proprietary software. And one of the things that happened is when we were using these Google APIs and it comes with these packages from them, they were just embedding in different packages that didn't allow us for proprietary usage. So you also need to like figure out with the legal department, you really need to like check, okay, you know, I'm using their standard libraries, what libraries are they calling? Are all those libraries, you know, what are the licenses that they are invoking? And is that okay if you build on top of that? So you initially you think it's like this is the easy option, but then not necessarily that much. Okay, so then we move up one scale, right? So we're slightly more proficient in AI. The services, for some reason, is not cutting our use case. So we go into what they call the so-called AutoML. So it's assisted modeling. And that means that you can, let me maybe go to the website. Here, yeah. Okay, so I went to GCP, and then you can just create a new project, and essentially you can create a data set, and it's all kind of like GUI-based. You can do a command line, of course, if you're like hardcore and you think that's the better option for you. But this is, of course, nice, you're in a presentation. And then they have a bunch of tutorials. So this is about recognizing objects in a salad, right? So it's like the bounding boxes indicate that there's tomatoes here in your training set in order to recognize tomatoes in future pictures. And yeah, so the only thing you need to do is create a project in the Google Cloud, upload your data set, and then you can just press train, and even like evaluating your metrics or everything can be done here in this GUI.
And these are the initial tagging. When I do the training, do I do it myself manually? How do I do the initial training? I mean, I have the first, let's say, one of the photos, and I want to show in which specific area there are the tomatoes. Who is doing the training?
Well, the training or annotating?
Just this, let's say, box that is marked over there, this is a tomato.
Yeah, okay, so this is interesting. Yeah, so you're discussing annotation of the data sets. So early, remember when I was saying that we have these two different situations of data sets, so either we know what's in the data set or we don't. So in this example, we need to know what's in the data set and where. So even though these companies are really kind of like making the training of these algorithms a commodity, right? So you don't need to do that much for it anymore. Creating these data sets is like massive work. And there's companies starting out making this kind of like trying to make this an easier thing to do. But the majority of your work actually goes into creating kind of like data sets where, you know, I've spent days kind of like not necessarily annotating tomatoes, but other objects that were of interest for the project I was working on. So this really sucks if you're like lowest in ranks in the company, because then it's like, okay, are you busy? You have to help me out, create a data set. So yeah, that's, but people will almost hopefully come up with more creative solutions for that in the future. But there's other stuff you need to think about, because so essentially, we moved away from being an AI engineer, and now you're becoming more of a data set engineer, right? Because you have to create this data set, and then the cloud is going to do kind of like the creation of the algorithm for you. But there's actually a lot of kind of like tricky aspects to that as well. So who's familiar with the husky wolf situation here in the bottom? Anybody familiar with that story?
Is it the logo of
photographer? Is it what?
The logo of photographer.
No, so this is actually the case where they tried to build an algorithm that could distinguish between is it a husky or is it a wolf? And one of the interesting things is, well, the algorithm did great, right? So they trained the algorithm and they looked at the metrics and how well did it perform. And it was like doing perfect, right? It wasn't mixing any huskies and dogs. But then what turned out is that it wasn't actually doing that on the basis of the looks of the husky or the wolf, but it was just detecting if there was snow in the background. And this is where your work as a data set engineer becomes really important, because, you know, if you feed it or if you create these data sets where algorithms can get really messed up in, then that's, you know, what's going to happen. Okay, and then last but not least, so this is the example of full control. You said, no, I need to be able to kind of like manage everything, all these, you know, shortcuts don't cut it out for the use case I'm working on. And this is kind of like a screenshot of our Azure DevOps environment, actually, you know, where you're just going to manage everything yourself. So like figuring out what libraries to use and then which version of the library to use. And then, you know, everything source code, you're importing all the packages yourself, everything. And one of the reasons why, you know, this is still in the cloud a massive breakthrough for AI is, like I've been mentioning it a few times before, being able to build intelligent algorithms goes hand in hand with having really large data sets. And before, in companies, you can't really imagine, but whipping up infrastructure is really like, oh, you have to send in this form and knock down this guy's door. And just the fact that when you work in the cloud or if you apply to a company in the cloud, you can just whip up an infrastructure, assuming these guys are going to give you a budget. But within seconds, that allows you to kind of like build that infrastructure. And the other aspect, of course, is collecting data, right? So that's also like a very important aspect. And that's definitely this one. Okay, now there's been some negative news for the cloud. So I'm kind of curious to know how many people own like an Alexa at home or a Google Assistant? No one? Yes. Is it perhaps related to...
Oh, yeah. Your parents? Maybe not your house.
Okay. So, it's been in the news recently a lot that, you know, they were all admitting that these assistants were actually listening into your conversations. So, okay, so why do they listening, guys? Why do they do this?
Data.
Yes, getting data sets, right, and getting it labeled. So some people need to check, like, are they doing it right or are they not doing it right? Or like, if it doesn't hear the cue. So I totally get this, right? And initially when I was hearing this, I was like, no, but I get this. I'm an AI engineer. But I have to say, it's a little uncomfortable, right? That people were like telling about what they heard in these conversations. So I have to admit, honestly, I kind of like, I have my assistant, but it's no longer kind of like hooked onto electricity, because I think we need to think a little bit about the boundary conditions in which we allow for the retraining of these systems. Okay, and then you're like, okay, I've got all this stuff nailed down. I really want to go pro now. Then this is like, you know, AI advanced level. Which is responsible AI, because I think in the last years, if I look at, you know, from an analytics data science community perspective, people were building models and they were very focused on metrics on the models, maybe not that much on the ethical aspects of the models that have been built. And I think that that's going to be a major aspect that the community is going to focus on. And there's really cool libraries that people are now developing in order to investigate if models that are being built, if they discriminate in age or in gender. So one of the things, like Amazon built a recruiting tool who did like CV selection, and it had a bias against women, but gender was not anything that the model was allowed to use, right? So it was kind of like inferencing gender from other parameters and stuff. So very interesting, very advanced field, and I think that's going to be very important for you guys. Probably when you graduate, it's going to have a much larger role to play. So I would recommend checking out these libraries that are really trying to, you know, make the first steps toward understanding how these algorithms make their decisions. Okay, cool. I think we're a little bit on the end of time. Cool.
Awesome. So now we have about 8 minutes for questions. So I'll pass around the microphone, and then if you want to ask a question, please talk until you get a microphone. Who wants to start first? All right.
Hi, thanks for the talk. So AIs, you said, were a lot like a black box, but obviously when you have an ethical problem, for example, or if you just want to know what your AI is doing, how would you go about that? So are there ways to kind of reverse engineer what your AI is doing?
Yes, definitely. So there's already some areas where they only allow essentially the usage of specific models, but there's a lot of reverse engineering going on, for instance, in computer vision, where you can try to manipulate the images just to get like a better understanding of what influences the prediction of an algorithm. And then the libraries I just showed also, they give insights in terms of the input parameters, or like the features that go into the model. SHAP and LIME. Yeah.
A question for Andreas. So a lot of these these services seem very useful and flexible. There's just one thing I wonder about. For example, with a VPN provider, they might say, for example, that they don't keep logs. In the same way, if you're ordering services from someone who provides an entire OS to you, you're just gonna have to take their word for it that they're not gonna track what you're doing. Or have there been any initiatives, or are there solutions to that? Are there like maybe auditing agencies or initiatives?
This is quite important, specifically for, let's say, from a privacy perspective. Also, that's why also you will see that medical companies, or if you see companies like banks, they are not that willing right now also to put their data on the cloud. Also, there are questions about, let's say, from GDPR perspective, if the data will be in the country or outside the country. Also, now what you will see that most of these companies also, they try to build the data centers on all the important countries. Like, for instance, Google, they have a data center in Groningen. Also, we have a lot of data centers in Ireland and Germany. But if they process the data, they claim no. For instance, if I put some data on a database that is being managed by them, then the question is no, that they do not process the data. Also, another action that they take from their side, they said that, you know, guys, we do not take your data and put them, for instance, on one hard disk. We take the data, we bring this data. Let's say if I upload a photo, I do not upload it as is on a specific hard disk. I just take this photo, I break it into pieces, I also encrypt it, and I save it somewhere in, let's say, not only one place, but in 10 different places. So even though somebody steals one hard disk, will not be able also to understand what is this data about. So theoretical, I mean, they do not track the data, they do not see what I am uploading, they cannot also process it. But also, they say always there will be a question, can I trust everything? Or maybe they might say that for performance reasons, we might have to track what is going on. But officially, the answer is no. Yep.
I have one for you. I'm wondering, since data sets are so important, is there like a Creative Commons of data sets out there?
It's a search engine, a data set search engine, for instance. But again, data sets, you also have to figure out what the licensing is under which they are released, and if you can use them for proprietary means and stuff. So it depends, again, on also, there's definitely search engines for data sets, but depending on what you mean to do with it, you have to investigate if the license is going to be okay for you.
Thanks again for talking. from my side. I have a question for you, Lisa. And you were talking in the end about biases. And I was wondering, what are the normal methods to get those biases out of the AI? I assume that there is a, like, one thing is just to make the data set bigger or more diverse. But is there also something you can do in tackling the algorithm, or like what's the normal procedure there?
Yeah, just maybe just to make an explanation on bias, right? So imagine, you know, any type of like experiment you do where you just, you know, test a random sample from your population is generally not going to represent your whole population, right? So imagine that in your population, you know, if it's uniformly distributed, you have all ages equally represented in your population. If you're going to randomly sample, you're going to see like small fluctuations generally. And one of the issues you see there is that if you then take that sample data set and you build an algorithm on top of that, it's going to display the same behavior, right? So if for some reason you could have that there's like a lot of 30-year-olds in your data set, and then, you know, that behavior is going to be more prominently represented. And one of the things you can do is you can kind of like artificially kind of like even that out, because you know it has to be flat. And that's one of the ways you do it. I think one of the questions we need to think about, right, is that, for instance, if you think, if you're like law enforcement agents, right, for instance, think about preventative, guys. Like on the street, if you want to just kind of like check people if they are holding any kind of like illegal stuff on them, right? So how does that work now? So police kind of like does this with this gut feeling of like, this person, I think we want to pull the person out of the crowd. What happens when we start building algorithms for this, right? So, and I think one of the things we're going to see is that, you know, we know that there's some kind of like bias in also our statistics, right? So we know like guys are probably more likely to carry around some forms of like illegal weapons than girls are. That would be my guess based on my personal experience. And then one of the questions is, if we don't want an algorithm that kind of discriminates on gender, then what we're going to do is we're going to correct for that, but that means we're going to be checking as much girls as we're checking guys. But we know in practice that guys carry more guns, right? So actually our metrics are going to be worse, because we're going to be, you know, we're not going to be as biased because we're investigating both genders, but the hit rate is going to be lower because we're investigating more women who carry less guns. And these are some of the complex questions we have to think about as a society. Like, okay, how do we do this the right way? And it's not always an evident answer. So there's definitely ways to kind of like balance it out, but is that what we want? And then, yeah, so those are really, really, I think, challenging but interesting questions that data scientists are going to have to address.
Thank you. And I will ask the last question, which is related to internships. That Andreas, you mentioned that it's a great time.
An email to Chin, just also to share it with you. There are internships also at Accenture. Actually, also I was telling to Chin in the beginning that this might be also the right timing. Also, we will share the link with all the available posts. So if somebody is interested, also they can drop an email either to Lisa or myself. Also, we will share our emails with you. So in case you have to do any assignment or whatever, also you will might get also the opportunity to work in Accenture for a couple of months and do your assignment there.
Awesome. So if you have more questions, that Lisa and Andreas will stick around a bit so you can talk to them afterwards. Apart from that, thank you very much for coming. And please, let's give a very huge applause to our great speakers today.